settle in, guys. I think many of you have already heard that today is my last day. In my desire to teach history in a way which I felt was more engaging than just dates and events, this past year, I decided to not use the state-approved textbooks. But I tried to provide you with a better understanding of how history unfolded from a different perspective, which is no doubt why today is my last day. Now, it may be historically accurate to say that Hitler was a decorated World War I hero. He didn't smoke and a vegetarian. But I think that omits some fairly important aspects of his life and who he was. As I've said before, it's impossible to ever really fully explain any historical figure. To do that, you'd have to get inside their heads to understand why they did what they did. Now, what we can do is look at exactly what they did and what they said. One of the most important historians of our time said, "The chief problem in historical honesty is not outright lying. It is omission or de-emphasis of important data." The definition of important, of course, depends on one's values. So, before I leave today, I want to talk to you about some things that your state-approved textbooks have chosen to leave out about two men, Christopher Columbus and Abraham Lincoln. So, let's say next month, an alien ship lands in America. Now, the captain, whose name is Submulok, first greets you with well wishes from their home world, and then tells us that he wants to trade some of their advanced technology for just a few of our natural resources. Within a couple years, we discover that they have the ability to render all nuclear weapons inoperative, and traditional weapons, firearms, are ineffective on them. They then tell us that we've been worshiping the wrong god the wrong way, but don't worry, they're going to teach us about the real god and how he needs to be worshiped. We've also been having sex the wrong way. Easy fix, as long as we do it the way they want us to, no problem. Now, it's very important to understand that they're actually only doing these things because they feel it's really a kindness on their part to civilize us, because, you know, we're technically immature savages. So then they explain to us that they are taking ownership of all the air above North America. They explain to us that even though the concept of air ownership is completely alien to us, it's actually a very well-established practice for all truly civilized interplanetary space explorers. So, now that it's been established that they own the air, leaving America is not an option for us. And anyway, we already owe them for the air that we've been using without paying for it. Now, the payment they demand is forced manual labor, digging and mining for a substance which is very valuable to them. Now, to make sure we are working just as hard as we should, Submulok, who, mind you, has no legitimate reason to believe the substance that he thinks is so valuable is actually here in the vast amounts he imagines, comes up with a system to motivate the Americans breathing the air which he and his people now own. So, every male over 14 is given a quota of this valuable metal to produce every 3 months. Everyone who produces the quota is given a necklace with a copper token on it. Those without the token get their hands chopped off. Now, Submulok's men sometimes just slice off pieces of Americans' arms to test the sharpness of their energy blades. And, you know, walking is sometimes exhausting, so they force the Americans to carry them on their backs like pack mules. Sometimes, when the aliens take these unpaid workers into more remote areas, they take just a few extra workers with them, you know, because the savage animals they need to keep to prevent these workers from escaping, well, they need to eat too. And these extra workers, they could be referred to as mobile dog food. So, if you have a wife, you'll see her once every 8 to 10 months. And she's so exhausted, the few children she does have trouble surviving because of the extreme overexhaustion, inhumane treatment, and new strains of diseases that Submulok's men have brought with them. But you know, life isn't easy for Submulok's men either. The supply of free American labor they've been using is growing dangerously low. The few Americans who have survived are either running away or committing suicide at numbers which adversely affects Submulok's business venture. And to make matters worse, one of the aliens, a high-ranking one, thinks that it may be possible that these Americans may have a Luos. We call it a soul. They call it a Luos. But the bottom line is, he's stirring up trouble, implying that it may be a sin to treat these Americans so cruelly. The solution? The Chinese! They don't have a soul and they work their asses off. And hey, it really shouldn't be that big of a deal because some of the Chinese in China are willing to capture them and sell them into slavery. And wait, even better. If a female slave gives birth, you own that slave too. A great system if you're an alien. If you're an American or Chinese, not so much. All right, now let's go ahead 500 years. You, the few Americans who haven't been massacred by the aliens, and the minority of the Chinese who have survived, are told that today, October 10th, 2512, is the day that we as a nation will celebrate Submulok, the great explorer who discovered America. Now, after Jesus, who's had more books written about them? There are over 15,000 books written about Abraham Lincoln, our 16th president, the great emancipator. He was Honest Abe who saved the Union and freed the slaves. There is literally a mountain of books chronicling Lincoln's life from the cradle to the grave. Now, I want to talk about some of the things the authors of those books have chosen to leave out. In 1858, during a debate, in order to prove he was just as big a racist as his opponent, Stephen Douglas, Lincoln said, he, referring to Douglas, goes on and deduces or draws out from my speech this tendency of mine to set the states at war with one another, to make all the institutions uniform, and set the niggers and white people to marry together. I debated whether or not to use that term. I find that term really very offensive. But I find it even more offensive that there seems to be this quiet desire to be sure that the people who would find it most offensive don't even know that it was used by our 16th president in his private and public life. Now, and to make sure the audience was clear as to where he stood, in the same debate he said, "I will say here, well, upon this subject, that I have no purpose, either directly or indirectly, to interfere with the institution of slavery in the states where it exists. I believe I have no lawful right to do so, and I have no inclination to do so. I have no purpose to introduce political and social equality between the white and the black races. There is a physical difference between the two, which in my judgment will probably forever forbid their living together upon the footing of perfect equality. And inasmuch as it becomes a necessity that there must be a difference, I, as well as Judge Douglas, am in favor of the race to which I belong having the superior position. I agree with Judge Douglas. He is not my equal in many respects, certainly not in color. Perhaps not in moral or intellectual endowment." Just before the Civil War broke out, Lincoln sent a letter to Alexander Stephens in 1860, who was a personal friend of Lincoln and served with him in Congress. Lincoln wrote, "Do the people of the South really entertain fears that a Republican administration would directly or indirectly interfere with their slaves or with them about their slaves? If they do, I wish to assure you, as once a friend and still I hope not an enemy, that there is no cause for such fears. Now, well, you can't remove the issue of slavery from the Civil War. 1 year after the Civil War had broken out in 1862, Lincoln was very clear when he said, "My paramount object in this struggle is to save the Union, and it is not either to save or destroy slavery. If I could save the Union without freeing any slave, I would do it. And if I could save it by freeing all the slaves, I would do it. And if I could save it by freeing some and leaving others alone, I would also do that. What I do about slavery and the colored race, I do because I believe it helps to save the Union." So, well, the eventual positive results of the Civil War for Black people was the 13th and 14th Amendment. Lincoln fought the war to reunite the Union. The issue of slavery was just the final blow to the South's desire to self-govern. The issue of slavery was just a tipping point to secession. In 1857, Lincoln was 48 years old, not a young man. Now, he was opposed to Kansas joining the Union as a slave state, which sounds like the right idea, the right position, until you look at why he opposed it. A separation of the races is the only perfect preventative of amalgamation. But as an immediate separation is impossible, the next best thing is to keep them apart where they are not already together. If white and Black people never get together in Kansas, they will never mix blood in Kansas. New states shouldn't be slave states, because that would mean Blacks mixing with whites. Now, just so we're clear, mixing doesn't mean hanging out. We're talking about interracial babies. Now, what about the states where Blacks are already living? Well, have you ever heard the term, "Why don't you go back to Africa?" This was Lincoln's solution. Let us be brought to believe it is morally right, and at the same time favorable to, or at least not against, our interest to transfer the African to his native clime. And we shall find a way to do it, however great the task may be. Now keep in mind, this wasn't a new idea. The ACS, or American Colonization Society, of which Lincoln was a member, was an organization that focused on freeing slaves and sending them back to Africa. The only problem, if they just landed anywhere along the African coast, they might just get picked up by slavers and land right back in America. Working with President James Monroe, the ACS helped found the country that is currently known as Liberia, so that these freed slaves would have a place to be shipped to. Lincoln's desire to remove the Blacks from America was not a one-time thing. In 1862, just a year or so into the Civil War, he made an agreement with a landowner, Ambrose Thompson, and a Kansas senator to send 10,000 Blacks to Panama and Colombia, which didn't work. Later that year, he tried to send 500 Blacks to a small island near Haiti. That also ended in disaster. On April 16, 1862, Lincoln signed into law a bill he'd shepherded through Congress. He said, "I am gratified that the two principles of compensation and colonization are both recognized and practically applied in this act." The bill he just signed would compensate the slave owners in D.C. for the 3,185 slaves they owned at $300 per slave to ship them off to a country that wasn't named America. September 22, 1862, Lincoln tells the South that he is going to emancipate or free their slaves if they don't rejoin the Union by January 1, 1863, 3 months later. Now, when that strong-arm negotiating technique didn't work, Lincoln officially emancipated or freed the slaves, but not all the slaves. States like Virginia, Tennessee, and Louisiana, which were still part of the Union but had slaves, they were allowed to keep their slaves. Just a couple weeks after signing this slave-freeing proclamation, Lincoln was back on his back to Africa kick, except this time not to Liberia, Panama, or Colombia. This time it was Belize in Central America. Just 4 days before he was assassinated, Lincoln met with one of his generals to discuss the issue of colonization. So this idea Lincoln had of a all-white America, or maybe more precisely, a black free America, this wasn't just some wacky idea Lincoln had on early in his life. It was actually his lifelong position. Now, when we talk about Columbus and Lincoln the way I have, you sometimes hear the word context, you know. Yeah, but you need to look at these men in the context of which they lived. Well, you know, back in the day, there were cultures where rape and murder were the norm, but that doesn't mean they weren't rapists and murderers. In Germany in the 1940s, anti-Semitism was the norm, but that doesn't mean they weren't anti-Semitic. So just because Lincoln wasn't hang a black guy under the tree racist, Lincoln was still a racist. Okay, there's the bell. Now, what I want you to take from me and remember is a new and sometimes radical way of looking at information. It requires that you look over and oftentimes past the official version of historical events to see what they've left out. To see history through the eyes of the victims of history can give us a better vision of who our historical heroes really were. Ladies and gentlemen, Senator Davis.
This campaign may end today, but the battle for you, the hardworking Americans who fought to build this country, rages on. Because every vote matters in our America, and we will honor each and every one of you who stood behind us and stood in line for your country. And I can't do this. Sorry, I can't do this. I know what they want me to say, what they expect me to say. But before I go, I am going to do something that my campaign manager would not expect at all. Got a stage, a microphone, and a captive audience. So why not do something that's unexpected of a politician and say something truthful? Do you know the difference between a car salesman, a pimp, and a politician? Well, it's rare, but every now and again, the car salesman and the pimp say something that's true. The three of us, we all are in the job of giving you less than what we take from you. And what do we take from you? Your vote? No. We take your money. It doesn't matter who you vote for, we take your money either way. We don't call it that, though. We call it taxes. The only way you can change something is to vote, right? And your vote is your voice, and your voice can't be heard unless you vote. Some of you actually believe this. These are meaningless little phrases that, we come up with these little catchphrases that convince you all to think that the things that are coming out of our mouths aren't the same things that are coming out of our asses. It's bullshit. I'll show you. A couple of years ago, a politician ran on the phrase, "Yes, we can," and won. What people fail to remember is that the campaign before that used the political phrase, "Yes, America can." They're meaningless little phrases that we somehow get you to chant and think that believing in the candidate is the same thing as believing in yourself. It's bullshit. Car dealers call it bait and switch. Magicians call it misdirection. Politicians, well, we call it whatever we seem to be talking about at the time. There's an issue that's usually a hot button issue, and we think that it's important, so we push it. But right now, we have voter suppression. Seems pretty cut and dry, right? Telling a large group of people that they can't exercise their constitutional right to vote unless they obtain a piece of identification that they currently don't have, clearly haven't needed, and may not even be able to get with ease. Then, when you look at who's pushing this legislation and who it disproportionately affects, it becomes a real sexy issue. If the security at your bank showed you a video screen, a large video screen that showed you one of your office clerks going into the storage closet and taking out a box of pens and putting it in their knapsack, well, you would agree that on any level, that's stealing. But if you saw on a smaller dust-covered video monitor that the vice president of the bank is loading pallets of cash into his trunk, voila. Liberals tend to think that protecting the voting rights of minorities and the elderly and the poor is admirable. Conceptually, yes, it is. The one thing that liberals and conservatives tend to agree on is that our votes matter. Newsflash, your vote isn't even counted. Well, not accurately. The way you know that your vote isn't counted accurately is if you ever hear the phrase margin of error. You don't see that type of thing on your bank statement. The way that you know your money is important is by how accurately they count it. They count your deposits and your withdrawals down to the penny. You don't have a balance of $25,000 plus or minus 3%. You remember back in 2004, all that drama that was going on in Florida? The hanging chads, the miscount, the recount, the legal maneuvering to stop the count, to recount the count, you know, all those important things, all those big problems? Those were the misdirection. And that senior bank officer I was telling you about that stole the money, the media attributed all that to a faulty memory card. Faulty. Sounds like no one's responsible for it. It's a manufacturing glitch, right? Okay, yeah. Well, if you ignore the official spin, you would have learned that after Gore retracted his concession to Bush, they found that there was a precinct that assessed 16,002 negative votes against him, all due to a faulty memory card. Okay, let me be clear. I'm not saying that there were 16,002 voters who didn't get their votes counted. What I'm saying is that after the memory card was uploaded to count your oh-so-valuable votes, 1 hour later, somewhere, someone uploaded another memory card. And all of a sudden, Gore comes up with 16,002 negative votes to his campaign. He's reduced by 16,002. And that's not even the most outrageous part. In the county where these 16,002 votes came from, there were only 585 registered voters, all due to a faulty memory card that hasn't been found yet. Ralph Nader cost him the election, or poor black neighborhoods who didn't have updated voting machines. Those are the reasons for the hanging chads, right? Our country is quietly moving towards a system of digital paperless voting. one in which you won't even be able to have a true audit. And here, the security officer has us focused on the storage room and a box of pens. Let's pretend that we could vote every single person out of office right now and replace them with new men and women, honest and true. The problem isn't the offices that these people hold. No, no. That's not the real problem. Well, they are, you know, those people are a problem, but they're not the real problem. The real problem is the system that these power-hungry, honest, petty, principled, idealist, or elitist people, the system that they're in is systemically corrupt. In the 1970s, the New York Police Department was corrupt from top to bottom. Every cop that came in there either became corrupt themselves, turned a blind eye to corruption, or they tried to act like what was going on was not. Our current country has evolved into a system that allows lobbyists to give mountains of money to each political party. And you sit up here and you think that your inaccurately counted vote matters? A football fan writes a check for the Dallas Cowboys for all of their material, all of their gear and everything, because he loves this particular team. Another football fan writes this same check for his Pittsburgh Steelers, and the two of them go back and forth, arguing over who's better. All the while, the NFL is cashing both of their checks. If you went to court and found out that the company that's suing you during the trial hired an outside firm to take the judge to expensive meals under the pretext that they're explaining the merits of the case to the judge over a meal. They spend $5,000 funneling money and things down to this judge and win a $50,000 settlement against you. Crazy. You'd be rightly outraged to find out that the branch of government that is in charge of enforcing the laws, the judicial branch, was this corrupt. But what I explained to you just now was the same thing that happens in the legislative branch of government who writes the laws. But we're too focused on the warmongering Republicans, the warmongering hypocritical Republicans, and pointing a finger at them while they're pointing a finger at the nanny, state-loving, job-killing liberals, all focused on a box of pens. We have a system that allows millions of taxpayers' dollars to be paid to no-bid contractors. And here I thought the one irremovable component of capitalism was competition. Vote every congressperson out of office, and the new representative will have to deal with the fact that the military contractors have spread their manufacturing chains to every state across the country. And reducing the military's budget means reducing the number of jobs, and reducing the number of jobs means less votes. In 2008, we had a candidate who said if he were elected, he would finally end the abuse of no-bid contracts once and for all. The days of sweetheart deals for Halliburton and the like are over. This same man also said that he would ensure that federal contracts over $25,000 would be competitively bid. In 2010, KBR, which is a spinoff of Halliburton, received a $568 million no-bid contract from the White House. This year, SIGA Technologies received a no-bid contract to produce a smallpox vaccine at a higher rate per unit than the government even thought reasonable. We have a system that gives a single vote in Delaware more weight than a single vote in a large state. How much more? Let's take New York. Population, 19 million. Total electoral votes, 29. And then if you add the 16 least populous states together, their population is about 20 million. And their total electoral votes is 62. Look, as the phrase goes, and ladies, I'm sorry, I don't mean to be sexist, but one man, one vote. But that's not what we have here. No, not by any stretch of the imagination. And that's why we've had 44 presidents, and three of which their opponents had more votes than they did. What do you call a sport in which every score is not counted all the time, just some of the time? Or where the loser is deemed the winner 7% of the time? You'd call it bullshit. So how do we right the wrongs? Do we run for office and try to fix the problem from the inside? Do we vote in honest men and women to higher offices? Or do we check out, not bother to vote or engage in any way because it's useless? A systemically corrupt system can't be corrected. But that's not true. This country still has real unaddressed racial problems, but it's nowhere near where it was in the 50s and 60s, especially with overt racism. If you take a long look at history, you'll see that the real change never came from inside the corrupt system. It came from the outside agitators causing stress and pressure to the people who ran the system, forcing them to change it, or it, along with their current position, would collapse into chaos. That is the only change that I can believe in.
Hi, my name is Timothy Allen Jensen. The guys, well, I call them the guys. Hey guys!
Fuck you!
Ha, those guys. You know, but when I think about it, what they actually are drug dealers. No, that's not exactly right. Drug sellers. They don't really make deals. Well, if you're a white girl that's not completely busted, they might make a deal, but a good rule of thumb is the price is the price is the price. The only real exception to the rule is the testers. That's what I am, Tim, the tester. That's me over there. Well, that's how you see me in the real world. But this is how I see myself, Tim, the tester. You see, we're kind of like a public relations firm that makes sure everybody knows. The guys, they cut it. And based on how close we come to dying is how popular that batch will become. Listen, you gotta work really hard to be promoted to the position of a true fiend who gets his shit for free. You know, it's not easy to do, but if you're dedicated. What is up with that lean? I mean, you've seen junkies tilt at inhumane angles, but you never seen one fall over, have you? Well, it's usually best to begin at the beginning. I was born 24 years ago. To be specific, 24 years, 3 months, 12 days, 6 hours, 4 minutes, and 27 seconds. It sounds so weird. But within minutes of being born, I had so much. I had a name. I had a birth certificate and not some certificate of live birth like some people. I had the unfulfilled dreams of the people that created me to accomplish. I had options. While it was all uncharted and unknown, I had a future. But most importantly, I had the unconditional love of two people. Even though I had never done a single thing to justify that love, except, you know, not die in childbirth and growing 10 fingers and 10 toes. That's all I did. And they loved me. They were going to feed and care for me when I couldn't do for myself. Now look, at the time, I thought that was quite generous. That's pretty much what I thought until about third or fourth grade when they started coming at me with this. You gotta do well in school if you wanna grow up and be successful. They ain't know it at the time, but I stopped believing some of the shit they told me. My first clue that they weren't 100% came when I asked them, where babies come from? You know the story. I let that one slide. Then I found out about the Tooth Fairy, Santa Claus, and the Easter Bunny. What am I, some jerk off over here, huh? A chump, a hump you can just tell some story to and I just believe it? The thing is, when they told me those stories, I did believe them. That is, until the kids at this school they wanted me to go to called me a jerk off, a chump, a hump. Let me tell you something, there's no sound quite as painful or as piercing as kids your age or younger laughing at you. Nothing comes close, nothing. Is that why I'm a junkie? No. Did you think that was my point? No. Yeah. But these people who said they loved me and had my best interest at heart, these people lied to me. They didn't lie all the time. They just could from time to time not be trusted to tell the truth. And I'm sure they thought these stories were fun for me, given the fact that my friends' parents were telling them these stories as well. But here's the crazy part, right? Whenever I did something stupid one of my other friends did, they'd hit me with this. Well, if all of your other friends jumped off of a bridge, would you? Kids don't know the actual word hypocrisy, but they know it when they see it. I one time watched my teacher who explained how awful it was that people got addicted to drugs smoking a cool menthol cigarette in the teacher's parking lot. She was getting into her car and she pulled out this square box, patted it against one hand, and one of these white tubes came halfway out. Can you see it? Can you see her in your mind? She's black, isn't she? No. Admit it. I said menthol and your mind said black. I mean, what is it with black people and menthol cigarettes? I was so young. But when I saw her smoking every free chance she could, it was like she was, what's the word? Addicted. Yeah, like she couldn't stop if she wanted to. The first time my dad talked to me about drugs, he had a beer in his hand. My mother, she had the decency not to even bother giving me the talk. Probably too busy getting a prescription filled for one of those endless bottles of legal medication that filled her bathroom cabinet. Kids don't know the word hypocrisy, but they know it when they hear it. So the people I'm supposed to trust and tell me the truth, my parents, sometimes lie. Okay, well, I tell you what, sometimes I'll believe them. But at the same time, it's my friends who opened my eyes to this new concept of people. Even those I at one time trusted as being full of shit. Hey, you. Yeah, you, in the red shirt, tell me something. Nah, you're full of shit. What about you? Nah, you're full of shit too. See, that became my new thing. I could spot the bullshit a mile away. So when my parents took me to this place on Sunday and there's this guy standing on stage talking about the invisible guy who knows if you've been naughty or nice. No, wait, I'm mixing my stories. Santa is the naughty or nice guy who gives you yearly installments of goodies based on how deep in debt mom and dad are willing to go. God gives you the massive lump sum payout when it's time to check out. So I'm looking at this guy. And he's standing there wearing a dress surrounded by these 10-year-old boys who are also wearing dresses, taking tax-free donations because the invisible guy in the sky and his son needs your money. And I say, you're full of shit. So when my parents tell me, you know, Don't ever try drugs because all drugs are bad. Do I listen? Do I believe them? Even though I know that they're full of shit? And as a teenager, it was so much fun identifying people who were full of shit that, well, hey, I failed to stop and check my level of shit. The cephalic vein in this arm has collapsed. No longer usable for, well, what I'd like to use it for. Cephalic vein, yes, that's the word for this vein. Oh, how does a junkie know that this vein is called the cephalic vein? Did you, Mr. Redshirt, know that this vein was called the cephalic vein? No, I did. I learned that my first year in medical school. Yeah, medical school. Wasn't born a junkie. It takes time and effort to become a junkie. Nope, my parents had money, but I got into medical school on a scholarship. Pretty darn smart, huh? Probably smarter than you, Mr. Redshirt. You a junkie? No. Oh, probably not smarter than you, but pretty darn smart. I had this really great AP American history teacher.
So, Lincoln issues the Emancipation, 1863, stating that slaves who live in the areas of armed rebellion are free. Now, this would be like telling your next door neighbor who hates you that his children are free to drive his cars whenever they want, but he still refuses to give them the keys. Now, it's important to realize that the Emancipation did not apply to areas in the North or Union-controlled areas where slavery still existed. So, 1865, the South loses the Civil War and the 13th Amendment is passed, making slavery illegal, except, and this is key, for the punishment of convicted criminals. 3 years later, 1868, the 14th Amendment. If you're born here, you're a citizen, regardless of race. Now, most people think incorrectly that this amendment guarantees this right to anyone in the United States who is a citizen over the age of 21. But sorry, ladies, only guys got the right to vote. Now, if you actually read Section 2 of the 14th Amendment, it's pretty clear it gave states a choice. So, allow black men to vote, or the number of representatives allotted to your state on a national level is decreased by the number of men not allowed to vote. So, your national representation depends on how many people you let vote. But the reality is that in the South, this section, Section 2, was not paid any attention to. So, black men were counted as voters, but they were not allowed to vote. So, for many Southerners, it was the best of both worlds. Let's go back to 1865. The South passes a series of black codes that target, well, black people. They were updated, revised, and improved, and eventually became what should be called neo-slavery, or slavery 2.0. The South passed a whole new set of laws that anyone could be charged and convicted with, black or white, but who do you think was charged and convicted the vast majority of the time? I will give you three guesses, but the first two don't count. Black men were charged and convicted of crimes such as walking along a railroad track, speaking too loudly in the presence of a white woman, selling vegetables after dark, and my personal favorite, vagrancy, which didn't mean, well, being a vagrant. It meant being unable to provide proof of employment. Who had a paycheck stub back in 1890? So now you're arrested by the local sheriff and his cousin, the judge. Here's your case, and surprise, 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 finds you guilty and assesses a fine that can be up to one or two times the amount of money that you make in a year. You see, it has to be high because his salary, the judge, as well as the sheriff, is paid by your fine. So now you don't have enough money to pay your fine, but a mining company or a lumber company or some other wealthy landowner does. So he pays your fine, and now he owns you for however long he and the honorable judge decide. Now, I know it sounds a bit strange, but for far too many, actual slavery was better than neo-slavery. With actual slavery, when you owned a slave, you owned him for the duration of his lifetime, so you could only mistreat him or abuse him so much. Now, they were literally disposable. You could work a slave to death, and for just pennies on the dollar, buy a new one. One Southern businessman said, "Before the war, we used to own the Negroes. But these convicts, we don't own them. One dies, get another." To give you an idea of the working conditions, they worked slaves in metal smelting plants. Now, the guards were not allowed to wear firearms due to the fact that the heat was so intense that it would ignite the bullets in their guns. Another aspect of neo-slavery was called debt slavery or peonage, in which you were only allowed to buy supplies and sell your crops to your landlord, who set the price of your rent, the supplies you bought, and the crops you grew. So it was no wonder that no matter how hard you worked, you could never get out of debt. Now, if you were educated enough to realize that your constitutional rights were being violated, and you wrote a letter to the Attorney General's office, they would simply refer you back to your state officials, the same state officials who were allowing this to happen. Now, this pattern basically existed undisturbed until 1942. Now, the president at the time, President Roosevelt, was worried about the possibility of German and Japanese propaganda about the inhumane treatment of black people in America, which was based in truth, but would destabilize or undercut the black support for war in America. Now, there was even concern that black people might be a security risk if their government continued to allow their mistreatment. So, 1942, the first prosecution and conviction of Alex and Susie Skrobercheck, who held a black man, Alfred Irving, for at least 4 years and beat him with whips, ropes, and even chains. So, well, 1942 was not the end of slavery. It should be considered the beginning of the end of slavery.
1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. 1942, the beginning of the end. 1942, wow. You wanna hear something else even crazier? Back in 2007, in April, I came across this People magazine that someone had thrown out. It had a story about Mae Miller, who alongside with her mother was raped by members of the family that owned her family. She was 5 years old. Pause briefly and let that thought detonate in your brain. 5 years old. The ongoing abuse had reached a point to where one morning she refused to clean her slave owner's home. She ran away after the man who owned her threatened to kill her. She was 18 years old and the year was 1961. In high school, I hated history. It was the definition of boring. The playwright Eugene O'Neill said, "There is no present or future, only the past happening over and over again now."
So, if we look at heroin, cocaine, marijuana, their early usage in America, and the process by which they became illegal was just another method of targeting ethnic minorities. Now, what's another way to say that?
Institutionalized racism.
Exactly. Some events in history just happen. And a simple explanation is all that is needed to understand them. Now, with other events, a little more context is needed to understand not just what happened, but why it happened. In 1948, couple of flecks of gold were found in Sutter Mills, California. And the next 7 to 8 years is what we call the California Gold Rush. Now, right at the outset of the Gold Rush, many groups immigrated into the United States, specifically California. The Chinese immigrated at a rate that far surpassed any other groups. Now, you add that to the fact that they were willing to work extremely hard for extremely low wages, and the white Americans, who, for some reason, didn't see themselves as immigrants, began to show their dislike of these Chinese and other foreigners through the legal system. So a few years into the Gold Rush, in 1950, California passed the Foreign Miners License Law, which was not so much a license as a $3 per month tax on foreigners, which was outrageous considering that the average Chinese miner earned only $6 a month. Now, in 1854, the California Supreme Court freed a white man who was convicted of killing Ling Sing because the three primary eyewitnesses in his trial were Chinese. It had been previously established that Indians and blacks were not allowed to testify against white men. Now, the court determined that Indians didn't mean Indians. It meant anyone of Mongolian descent, and blacks didn't mean blacks. It meant anyone who wasn't white. So, after overturning the murder conviction, the court referred to the Chinese people as a race of people whom nature has marked as inferior, and who are incapable of progress or intellectual development beyond a certain point. In 1852, there were just under 12,000 Chinese people living in California. 7 of them were women. That's 1,700 guys for every gal. Over the years, the Chinese population grew. The number of men greatly outnumbered the women, and this was not an accident. There were actually laws making it difficult for Chinese women to immigrate into America, and there were also laws that made it difficult for Chinese men to come back to America if, at any point, they returned to China. Well, we know that a great many different people helped to build the railroad, but we don't really realize how many of them were Chinese. In 1856, the first 50 Chinese men were hired to work on the railroad when a group of white workers threatened to strike. In 2 years, for every 10 men working on the railroad, 9 were Chinese. So, with an ever-growing population of Chinese men and very few Chinese women, these men turned to one of the very few pleasures they had brought with them, the smoking of opium. Now, opium contains, well, opium, and laudanum contains opium and alcohol. The difference being, if you were white and drank your opium in the form of alcohol, no problem. If you were Chinese and you smoked your opium, you could be looking at anywhere up to 2 years in prison and a fine of $50 to $5,000. You adjust that for inflation, that's $1,200 to $120,000, and I don't care how hard a worker you are, that's insane. And these were some of the very first anti-drug laws in America. One of Oregon's legislators was quite clear when he said, "Smoking opium is not our vice, and therefore it may be that this legislation proceeds more from a desire to vex and annoy the heathen Chinese in this respect than to protect the people from the evil habit." A report from the American Pharmaceutical Association said, "If the Chinaman cannot get along without his dope, we can get along without him." So first, Congress decided that Americans could import opium, not Chinese. Then Congress decided that this American imported opium could only be processed by Americans, not Chinese. A few years later, smoking opium was illegal. Drinking it was okay because that's how white men got their fix. If you smoked it, it was considered Chinese, and that was illegal. So, next up, cocaine. In 1908, The New York Times, in this article, the growing menace on the use of cocaine. In a most casual way, stated that there is little doubt but that every Jew peddler in the South carries the stuff. 4 years later, the Times article, "Negro cocaine fiends are a new Southern menace." You can just imagine what's in this article. And many other officers in the South who appreciate the increased vitality of the cocaine-crazed Negroes have made a similar exchange for guns of greater shocking power for the express purpose of combating the fiend when he runs amok. So, not only does cocaine make the Negro, not people in general, but the Negro, a more efficient killer, but it makes him harder to kill. But I believe the record of the cocaine nigger near Asheville, who dropped five men dead in their tracks using only one cartridge for each, offers evidence that is sufficiently convincing. The Literary Digest. That same year, in the article, "This Drug-Endangered Nation," quoted Dr. Christopher Koch, who said, "Most of the attacks upon white women in the South are the direct result of a cocaine-crazed Negro brain." So, the Jews sell it to them, and these superhuman killers are super hard to kill, and if you're one of those lucky enough to have a white woman, well, Miss Patty Jean Lulu Bell's virtue is in danger of the cocaine-crazed Negro. So that same year, 1914, the Harrison Act was passed, which effectively made opium and cocaine illegal. Now, let's talk about weed, cannabis, pot, that sticky icky. Brownsville, Texas, 1903, one of the first places to ban cannabis. Brownsville experienced an influx of foreigners who smoked marijuana, and by foreigners, I mean Mexicans. Now, these businesses, who were more than willing to hire these people who worked at extremely low wages to increase their profit margins, were silent when the anti-Mexican sentiment got really ugly. Their silence was almost deafening, and 100 years later, not much has changed. Now, when Harry Anslinger testified before Congress in 1937, he was trying to, well, let's just let his own words say what he was trying to do. "I wish I could show you what a small marijuana cigarette can do to one of our degenerate Spanish-speaking residents. That's why our problem is so great. The greatest percentage of our population is composed of Spanish-speaking persons, most of who are low mentally because of social and racial conditions. There are 100,000 total marijuana smokers in the U.S., and most are Negroes, Hispanics, Filipinos, and entertainers. Their satanic music, jazz and swing, result from marijuana usage. This marijuana causes white women to seek sexual relation with Negroes, entertainers, and any others." And one of my favorites, "Reefers make darkies think they're as good as white men." There were also newspaper articles which were supporting Anslinger. They listed crimes and they said that marijuana influences Negroes to look at white people in the eye, step on white men's shadows, and look at a white woman twice. Mr. Anslinger was working on this new piece of legislation, the Marijuana Tax Act. Sounds like a tax on marijuana, right? Well, yes and no. There was a small tax that you had to pay if you had any dealings with marijuana. You paid the tax and you received a stamp. The stamp made it legitimate for you to sell, grow, buy, or possess marijuana. Now, the twist was that they never had any intention of actually issuing any of these stamps. You had to go to DC to get this stamp, and to ask for it, you had to present the marijuana. Now, the fact that you possessed the marijuana and transported it to DC to ask for the stamp meant that you had already broken the law by transporting and possessing the marijuana without the stamp. So, throughout the history of this country, to varying degrees, race or racist agendas have shaped and, for lack of a better word, colored the laws which are still with us today.
Can you believe she taught high school? Well, they had to fire her. I used to think history was about what did or didn't happen. I didn't realize the college, it's about what you choose to teach did or didn't happen. Sorry. It happens from time to time. Where was I? College, yes. My girlfriend, well, one of my girlfriends. Hey, look, I might look like a shit sandwich with a glass of urine on the side, but back then, I was big pimping. So my girlfriend was telling me about this political science course being taught by this ex-senator.
We will be looking at the connections between crime, the for-profit prison structure, and the sentencing guidelines that create an ever-increasing number of prisoners and profit. We're going to call that the prison industrial complex. When society decides that the punishment for violating an established rule is incarceration, there is a cost-benefit analysis. The cost of keeping a person in prison weighed against the continued damage that they can do to society if they're not jailed. It also is the combination of punishing the person for rule violation and protecting the rest of society from that rule violation that may harm them. A portion of our tax dollars goes to pay for the rule enforcement, the incarceration, and the after-release monitoring. Many times in an effort to, say, provide the prisoner with skills, the cost of imprisonment is deferred by allowing a for-profit company to contract out prison labor at pennies on the dollar. This country has a long history of coming up with massive amounts of wealth by using slave labor. It's really easy to create high profit margins when you're not paying the person that is helping make the product that you're selling. Many of the people who are in jail should be in jail. The problem is, a lot of the people that are there shouldn't be, and I want to take this time to talk about those people. We can't really pinpoint one reason why those people are put in jail. But let's look at it this way. When a fly is caught, he's not caught in a single spider line. It's a spider web. Web is a series of interconnected lines that form a pattern that, when touched, is almost impossible to break free of. Let's see if we can identify the line to this web. There's a vast majority of police officers who do a very difficult and dangerous job, and they are not corrupt. What do you think the percentage of corrupt officers would be if they were offered bonuses for the number of people they arrested? It's not happening now, but we have large corporations that run for-profit prisons that make millions. And their profits are directly tied to the number of people who are in jail and the amount of time that they spend there. Would it surprise any of you if they used an insanely small amount of their profits and paid lobbying firms, which in turn funneled down to an even smaller portion of that money to legislators to create longer, harsher sentences? What makes sense is that corporate officers need to find a way to make extra profit. Okay. But there are certain aspects of life, certain services that this profit motivation should be removed. We don't want a private for-profit police department or a private for-profit fire department, because if those services require profit, well, guess who's going to be on the shitty side of the toilet paper when it comes time to make the choice of less profit or doing what's best for the community that we're supposed to service? We're able to understand this concept when we see someone else's house on fire. But when it comes to crime, out of sight, out of mind. They get what they deserve. Let me ask you a question. Do you deserve to pay, I don't know, additional taxes so that the company that warehouses nonviolent drug addicts for years and years and years can continue to do that because they were able to use an insanely small amount of money and bribe, I mean, lobby the lawmakers into creating policies like mandatory minimums or three strikes and you're out legislation so that they in turn can make more profits. Let's look at who we're arresting, okay? On TV, you have the undercover cop who goes and arrests the drug lord or the drug dealer or the kingpin. But back here in reality, out of every 100 drug arrests, 80 are for possession. People buying the drugs to use the drugs. The war on drugs has accounted for an insane increase in the prison-related industry. One out of every 31 people, 7 million in the United States, is either in jail, on probation, or on parole. Think about how many jobs are directly or indirectly tied to this ever-expanding industry. Let's talk about profiling. Profiling can be a very effective way of using established patterns to target the types of people that we now call criminals. When looking for drug couriers, here's what a profiler can look for. Traveling with luggage, traveling without luggage, driving an expensive car, driving a car that needs repairs, acting too calm, acting too nervous, dressing casually, wearing expensive clothing or jewelry, being one of the first off the plane, being one of the last off the plane, being in the middle of the plane, using large bills, using small bills, traveling alone, traveling with someone, and the best one is trying to obey the law. A sign that you may fit the profile. The profile itself, as a concept and at its core, is, well, it's colorblind. But how is it used? In New York, they have what we call a program called Stop and Frisk. If you are white, you've probably read about it. But if you're black or Hispanic, you know about it. Take 100 people. In New York, 44 of them are white, 29 of them are Hispanic, and 23 of them are black. If you've stopped and frisked 100 people, 10 are arrested for some crime and 90 weren't. Of the 100 people you stopped, 10 were white, 34 were Hispanic, 53 were black. If the premise is that the majority of those 10 that you arrested was for drug-related crimes, that might explain why minorities are targeted. Wrong. Nationally, 70% of drug users are white, 14% are black, and 13% are Hispanic. What about the illegal guns if this program takes off the streets? Okay. Well, whites were in possession of guns at a 2-to-1 rate over blacks and Hispanics. What explains why certain people are chosen to be stopped and frisked? It's the racist execution of colorblind legislation. Look, here's something that you might find interesting, okay? Whites make up 64% of the population and 70% of the drug users. Hispanics make up 16% of the population and 13% of the drug users. And blacks make up 12% of the population and 14% of the drug users. Of course, all races, you know, all races use illegal drugs. But if you profile or target or focus or whatever you want to call it, one particular race, then you can disproportionately incarcerate minorities while at the same time you seem to appear to be enforcing the law. So the result is this. We have a people who make up 12% of the population, use 14% of the drugs, yet make up 53% of the sentencings to prison for drugs. If any one of those segments, the premise or the planning or the execution is racist, or when you choose to allocate your drug enforcement resources to particular neighborhoods, the end result looks like the prison system that we have now. W.E.B. Du Bois said, "The slave went free, stood for a brief moment in the sun, then moved back towards slavery." What we have now has been called preservation by transformation. The slave went free, stood for a brief moment in the sun, then moved back again towards slavery.
I'm sometimes amazed at how we don't see how things that literally happened hundreds of years ago directly affect what's happening today. But what's different is that ever since one group was able to kill another group, we've had this concept and the reality of slaves and slavery. But what was different was that what Columbus and those after him did was introduce a new concept to the slave structure. You weren't just a slave because we conquered you. You were a slave because that's who you and your race of people were. So while many people came to America as indentured servants, there was still this idea that this form of slavery was finite, would eventually end once, you know, your debt was paid or you died. But this new form of slavery was who you and your children and your children's children were. In 1662, Virginia passed a law which made it clear any child born, if the mother's a slave, the child is too. That's why all black people in America aren't Wesley Snipes black. You see, the white slave owner could rape the woman he owned because the rights to her body was not her decision. Thank goodness that doesn't happen today, right? Old white men telling women what they can do with their bodies, right? So the slave woman comes up pregnant, and the man who rapes her has no financial or parental responsibility because the child of a slave woman is a slave. Oh, and by the way, if a white woman had sex with a black man willingly, she too could lose her freedom and end up a slave just like him, which may help explain why many women cried rape when they were caught with a slave. So we have this system which produces free or insanely cheap labor, which creates disproportional wealth, and then later it then declares slavery illegal, except when it comes to incarceration. But then they cleverly forget to set up a system that would punish or incarcerate those who kept or forced people back into slavery. We have for-profit prisons that are lobbying for longer and harsher mandatory sentencing when it comes to nonviolent crimes. Drug crimes. You know, in a way that's painfully similar. When we think of slavery, we think of like a black man in a field picking cotton. When the reality is a lot of the field work was done by women while the men worked in a wide variety of other industries like lumber or mining or steel foundries. If you didn't pay a man for his work in 1850, it was slavery. If you paid him just enough to survive and never get out of debt, it's called slave wages or peonage. If you find a way to charge him with a crime and then pay him actual pennies on the dollar, it's called prison labor. If the premise of the agenda is racist, the application is racially disproportionate, therefore the end result is racist. But if the process makes billions for the few who run the prison industry complex, just say no, a zero tolerance, mandatory minimums, tough on crime. Yeah, I really enjoyed those classes and I did pretty good overall my second year. But if I'm gonna be really honest, not as good as I could have. I had this really bad habit of waiting to the last minute to study for a test. Yeah. I had some other habits too. Okay, maybe you're a little more discreet when you adjust your undercarriage. It's something we all do, right? All right, maybe something we don't all do because I'm not wearing underwear, so I'm not exactly sure what I'm digging for right now. So anyways, where were we? College, yes. Partying. Oh man, I love that term. If anyone asked you what you were doing tonight and you said drinking large amounts of alcohol and taking illegal drugs, you sound crazy. Instead, you said partying. It sounds so much better. You know another term I love? Experimenting. It sounds so scientific, like we had these white lab coats and had these clipboards to chart the double-blind tests we were running. Since it's just you and us talking, if we're going to be completely honest, the only experimenting going on was me getting high. Oh, ooh, I got high, real high. So high I could touch the sky. And I experimented with a wide variety. Hey, like mom used to say, how are you going to know you don't like it if you haven't tried it? Nah, but look, the real problem is the only ruler I used to measure a drug was how I felt at its highest point. That's like a guy looking at $1,000 on his kitchen table. $1,000 looks pretty good. It looks pretty good until you think about the fact that you worked 40 hours a week for 4 weeks for $5 an hour, mopping up the peat booth floors at a store called Jerk the Chicken, and that's not a Jamaican restaurant, if you catch my drift. That's the real sticky icky, you know? When I was in my, I think second rehab, we were going over this conversation with my parents where they were telling me about how my drug addiction affected them. And I asked them, I said, what did your parents tell you about drugs? And can you believe that they admitted that their parents had told them a similar version of the bullshit they told me? So instead of saying what they knew to be true about drugs, they just said some updated version of the bullshit that their parents told them, which they also ignored at my age, but then were somehow confused when their child ignored the same warning they ignored. Full of shit. Have you ever heard the term the law of diminishing returns? Most junkies have never heard the term, but they know what it means. Your first high is the highest you'll ever get, and you'll forever chase it until you kick, die, or graduate. First, you'll do twice as much, twice as often, and then you'll double that again, so now it's kick or graduate. And hey, look, quitting is for quitters, and do not call me a quitter, so you graduate. You go from cigarettes to pot to crack, and you end up at heroin, or if you're white from the Midwest and know the producers of A&E's intervention, you end up graduating to meth. Different strokes for different folks. There was this new word that I learned. Maintenance. I currently do enough heroin to kill a small horse, and that just keeps me from feeling like stir-fried shit. That's it. That feeling, oh, that felt so good. It's a thing of the past. It's a distant memory. It's like a memory of a memory. If I was gonna be completely honest with you, it's more of like a feeling than an actual memory. So I fix, just to keep my head above this ocean of pain that I'm floating in. And then one of those moments between fixing and trying to find money to get a fix, I was, as some would say, for a few moments, reflective. Who do I blame? My parents? My friends? A prison industry complex that profits off of incarceration. The street dealers, all the way up to the cartel heads who have perfected and perverted the concept of capitalism. The politicians who have labeled drug use as a crime instead of a chemical addiction, a health-related problem, because putting disproportional black or brown faces in jail, tough on crime, wins elections and treatment or rehab sounds too tree-hugging, hippie, liberal, unless it's your kid on the next A&E special. I might have been pressured, but nobody helped me down. I put those chemicals in my body. Yeah, I had help, but I did that. Should we do what Portugal did? Decriminalize the possession of all illegal drugs? Use that money for drug prevention programs and, more importantly, drug treatment facilities, instead of simply just taking those funds to warehouse their drug addicts? In 10 years' time, drug abuse drastically decreased, along with the crime associated with illegal drugs as well. You want an answer? Well, guess you can say you finally saw one fall over, right? Where were we? Yes. Assessing blame. Correcting and righting wrongs. But that's what the living do. That's your job, not mine. And I can't offer you any answers because, well, I'm dead. I guess this batch will be real popular.
Alright, alright, alright. You're gonna learn today.
Honey, there's a date you gotta sell it by. Otherwise it just expires and spoils. And these folks jump out the pot when the water too hot, cause the fire boils inside. You go to church to find you some religion, and all you hear is conniving and gossip and contradiction. And you try to vote and participate in the government, and the motherfucking Democrats is acting like Republicans. You join an organization that know black history, but ask them how they plan to make money and it's a mystery. Looking for the remedy, but you can't see what's hurting you. Revolution's here, the revolution is personal. They call me the political rapper, even after I tell them I don't fuck with politics. I don't even follow it. I'm on some KRS, Ice Cube, Chris Wallace shit. Main source, De La Soul, bumping to Apocalypse. Now, now. Say I'm intelligent. No, it's cause I'm dope. If I was whack, I'd be irrelevant. I'm like the dope in your tracks until your high is settling. You leaning to the left and laugh at the best medicine. But the trouble you have today, you just can't laugh away. Stay optimistic, think a change is gonna come like Donny Hathaway. You have to pray on top of that act today, cause opportunity shriveled away like Tom Hanks and Castaway. Everybody passed away, the pastor prayed a family mourning. Everybody act according to the season that they born in. We fight in the streets, start bleeding till the blood is pouring. In the gutter, mothers cry to the Lord, we living by the sword. And all that folks want is safety, they going gun crazy. Same reason Reagan was playing war games in the 80s. Same reason I always rock dog chains on my babies. The struggle is beautiful, I'm too strong for your slavery.